closed it. He don't change the witness in heaven. But just smile. Do you know Jesus? Do you really know him? But if we ought to smile, put your smile on and amen. Let Jesus shine through on today. All this time. Next voice you will hear will be that of Brother Sam D. Bailey of the Cedar Valley Church of Christ.
Lyrics about having some harvest time and worn out.
Bless. morning?
Good morning.
It is an absolute pleasure to be with you and be in Houston, Texas this morning. Every once in a while, it's good to the soul to get out of Dallas and head down 45 to H-Town. It's good to be here today. I must say I was very inspired and encouraged when I drove up in the parking lot and I saw so many people gathering and making their way into the house of the Lord. Shouldn't every Sunday look like this? And I believe that. I believe every Sunday should look just like this. And I believe that the Church of Christ, we are still relevant. No matter what people are saying, I think the church has got to stay with the truth. But I think the church has got to alter some methods, but we have to maintain our message. And God has blessed us to be here in this place. So it's just a pleasure to be here. And I'm just soaking up the audience this morning. And what an honor to be invited. There's power in an invitation. And I realize that in life, people don't have to ask you to do anything. So I'm grateful to the leadership here at South Union, as well as Brother Tucker said, now my good friend, Brother R.F. Tucker. And I think a lot of him and as a person. And his focus on ministry and serving God's people. I think a lot of them, you know, sometimes we don't realize what a good thing we have until it's gone. You thought you had a sorry man until you had no man at all. You were taking advantage of your wife until she stopped cooking chicken and stopped washing your clothes and picking up your toenail clippings. Y'all gonna stay with me this morning. And when you got a good preacher, hold on to him. Treat him right. Take care of him. I got an old dog. He got out the gate last week. He wandered all around the neighborhood, but when it was time to eat, he knew exactly where to come. And when you take care of him, he will take care of you. Departing to you the word of God, as well as your elders, for they watch over your soul. So I'm grateful to be amongst my contemporaries, as well as Brother Malcolm. You cannot, I can't describe Malcolm as any other word but gifted. And God has gifted him to do what he does, and he inspires people all across the country. So it's good to be on the platform and on the program with two great men such as this, and I'm humbled by the invitation today. I want to just make a few acknowledgments, and then I'm going to get on with my message. You know, I try not to be long-winded anymore. So they've been working on me pretty good at home. So I want to keep your attention this morning, but I have something to say. But I just want a few acknowledgments. As Brother Tucker said, I'm so glad to have my wife and two daughters, as well as one of their besties with us today. We're glad to have them, so thank God for headphones and everybody can listen to their stuff on the way up here. So glad to have them, as well as I see a couple of people from Cedar Valley. Are y'all here from Yosemite? And Cedar Valley is right outside of Dallas, so some of them made a trip. Thank God for y'all. There's Brother Lee, he's going to be one of our elders. And for the first time next month, 50th year of our history of our congregation, we're going to ordain four elders. So we're excited about that. So we're blessed to have them. As well as, I see a few friends of mine that go here, Leonard and Lisa Brown. There they are right there. They're members here at South Union. And we're glad to see them, as well as Brother Hooper over here. The other Hooper is with us. Mark is with us. So I'm just glad to see so many people I've seen throughout the city. And I don't have time to acknowledge everyone, but it's a blessing to be here. If you're here today and you're not a member of the body of Christ or the Church of Christ, we want to tell you that Christ is the best thing that could happen to your life. I pray this morning, if you have not made a decision to follow him, you ought to do so now. Often quote Paul when he says, what benefit do you now have in the things which you are ashamed of? All of us are going to get old one day. And some of us just stop sinning, not because we chose to, but because our bones and our arthritis would not let us sin anymore. But the Bible says it's the goodness of God which leads us toward repentance. And God has shown you grace. God has given you time. God has given you mercy. And you ought to want to walk away from the life of sin and shame and sorrow. You ought to want to step into this kingdom, being translated into the light, and walk in the light as He is in the light, and have fellowship with Him. And so this morning, if you're not a member of the body of Christ, you ought to have Christ. Galatians 3:27, Paul says, "For as many have been baptized into Christ, have what? Put on Christ." Paul tells us that when we put on Christ, we ought to walk in the newness of life. Paul tells us, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and all things are become new. And when you hear about this gospel is good news. And the good news is not only do I live a life of righteousness and have a life that is pleasing to God in this life, but also when this life is over, I believe that Paul is right when he said all of us must appear before the judgment seat of Christ. And we're going to have to give an account of the things which we have done in this body, whether they be good or whether they be bad. And so you want to be on the right side of this thing when your life is over. Somebody said, how do I get in Christ? Well, do you believe that He died on the cross for your sins? If you believe that, then you've got to repent of your sins. Hebrews 11:6, without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must first of all believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. Repent of your sins. Luke 13:3, except you repent, you shall also likewise perish. It's metanoia, a change of mind which results in a change of action. The prodigal son didn't repent when he came to himself. He repented when he showed up at his father's doorstep. He didn't change when he decided he wanted to come to Christ. But you've got to actually walk away from some things. And we'll ask you to make the confession that so many made before, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And then here's another thing that's widely debated, but I don't understand why. Because Jesus said it himself in Mark 16:16, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. Somebody says, is baptism essential to salvation? Well, I believe if Jesus said it's essential, it's essential. And baptism is not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, Peter writes, but it's an answer of a good conscience toward God. And so if you want to be right with God this morning, somebody said, what water? It don't matter if you get baptized in the Gulf of Mexico or Joe Pool Lake where we are, but you just need some water. You need to go down to that water, come up in that water in the newness of life, and be added to the body of Christ, the church of Christ. And you can make that decision this morning. I know it's Friends and Family Day. And I want to say some things to address relationships within our lives. And when you got somebody on your side, like we have this morning, you don't have to worry about things. And I think in our lives, it's important to have somebody, as they say in the military, to watch your six. Because I can see what's in front of me. But on life's journey, I need somebody. They talk back to me a little bit at home, so you don't have to talk back or say amen. Just nod your head a little bit and let me know you're with me, all right? But you got to have somebody to watch your back. Because behind me is where I'm most vulnerable. There's a reason why I can only fight going forward. Because I need someone to stand back to back and fight with me in this life. And when you know that you got somebody on your side that's looking out for you, then you don't have to worry about things. You know, when I go to sleep at night, I can lay my head down in peace. Number one, knowing that I'm right with my God. Number two, knowing that I'm right with myself. Number three, knowing that I'm right with my fellow man. And I realize that God is in control. He has protected me. He is watching over my house. And therefore, I don't have to worry about what's creeping through the neighborhood, because God can send that riffraff and that trouble right on by my house because I'm trusting in Him. It reminds me of an older lady. An older lady in her 80s, she was pulled over, and the police officer pulled her over because she was swerving back and forth across the lane. And we might have some people in here this morning that need their license revoked, so you understand what I'm saying this morning. So she was swerving back and forth across the lane, and police officer pulled her over and noticed that she had a .22 in her purse. And so he looked at me and said, ma'am, can I see your license and registration? And she gave it to the officer, and then he said, ma'am, do you have any more weapons? She said, yes, I have a .45 in the console, and then I have a 9mm in the glove compartment. And so the officer looked, and he looked at the woman. She said, ma'am, what are you afraid of? The old lady looked up at the officer, and she smiled. She said, not a doggone thing. When you know you got some heat on your side, you ain't got to worry. this morning. I believe isolation is unnatural. I believe it can be good at times. It can be useful for prayer, for meditation, for reflection and relaxation. For many people, solitary confinement works in their choosing. In other words, I like to be by myself sometimes. I like to talk to God by myself. I like to listen to God by myself. And solitary confinement is good when it's of your choosing for a set period of time. It's not good when the ward puts you in solitary confinement for misbehavior. And when you are forced to be out on the island by yourself for an extended period of time, it can do some damage to you. Stop running around saying that you don't need anybody. The biggest blessings of my life have come from people who are going the same direction that I'm going. People who are like-minded spirits. Even in the beginning, we read that God formed Adam, or man, from the dust and planted him in the garden. God placed man in the garden to tend to it, and the Bible says that he had everything he needed to succeed except a helper that was suitable or comparable to him. God thought it not good, even in the beginning, for man not to be alone. This morning, I want to take a closer look at the relationships we either build or neglect. See, no matter how great you think you are at using your inner circle, you're going to come across some times already where you're going to be by yourself. In Matthew chapter 26, as Jesus agonized over the fate of the world, he said in verse number 31, he says, all of you will be made to stumble of me because this night I will strike the shepherd, as he's speaking prophecy, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. And then here we go, a lot of us are like Peter. We always speak up too soon. And sometimes we have some friends who are like Peter. They mean well, but there are times where you got to just go through some things by yourself. People want them to do it. They have good intentions, but they can't always bear the cross that you got to bear. Jesus said, if you're going to follow me, you got to take up your cross and follow me. And so Peter says, Lord, he says, even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you. And all of his disciples said that. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane and said to his disciples, sit here while I go and pray over there. And he took with him, I want you to know right here, Peter, James, and John, and he began to be sorrowful and began to be distressed. And he said to them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. And he asked his friends, Peter, James, and John, those that obviously, if you study the word, that are closest to him, he said, I need you not to necessarily go to Calvary with me. I don't need you to come with me to Gethsemane and pray. I just need you to be around. I need you to be in the vicinity while I'm going through what I'm going through. And while I'm over here agonizing, I got a burden so heavy that I got to bear the sin of the world and the shame of the world. All of this is up on my shoulder, and I just need to be able to look over and see that you are watching and anticipating, and not just praying for me, but you are sympathizing with me. And he says, watch with me. And then he went a little further and fell on his face. And he said, Father, if it be possible, some of you are praying for a cup to pass. And you're saying, if it be possible, let this cup pass. Nevertheless, not I, but your will be done. Then he came to his disciples and found them sleeping. Some of us got some friends that are sleeping on the job, and we need to cut them loose. And he said to Peter, what, you could not watch with me 1 hour? He said, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. For the spirit is willing, what? But the flesh is weak. I want to start off by saying a few things. The first thing I want to say is that all of those who left you couldn't stay, and all of those who have stayed with you couldn't leave. All those that left you could not stay, and all those that stayed with you could not leave. It's unfortunate that you see so many Christians that find themselves despondent over people who have walked out of their lives. I've learned through ministry that divorce is like a death. There will be people who walk out of our lives because we grow apart. People grow apart in life, and especially if you give your life to Christ, you'll find folks that you used to run with. You don't do the same things that you used to do, and you don't think like you used to think. That's why the Bible says evil communications will corrupt the mind. Be careful who you hang around with. Y'all like cliches, so let me say this. If you roll around with, y'all wake up this morning, if you roll around with what? Dogs, you get up with what? Butterflies. With fleas. You'll know a man by his associations. Somebody says, I'm not a thug, I just roll with thugs. You know, I'm not a, I just sleep around.
Too much stuff. You are a slacker. You complain a lot. history like it's our destiny. Stop treating our history like it's our destiny. Some of us, God has been trying to move for years now, but we're trying to hold on to that old stuff when he's trying to put us in contact with new people who have new ideas, with new visions, with new passions, with new purpose. And Jesus was always with Peter and James and John, and he had them when he was transfigured on the mountain. Even in the garden, the higher you go, the smaller your inner circle becomes. The higher you go, the smaller your inner circle becomes. Some of us are not in trouble because we messed up on our own, but we're in trouble because we just talk too much to the wrong person. You become sensitive. Your life becomes magnified. And everything you do becomes scrutinized, and it's hard to find people who don't need anything from you. Some of y'all mothers experienced that. You got a child that only shows up when he needs $20. What are we having for dinner? My question, what you buy for dinner? There was a song that came out recently, young people, y'all know this one. I got fake people showing fake love straight up to my face. And then the hook says, I can tell that love is fake. What we have suffered with long enough in the church is being fake with one another. I don't have to be fake. I didn't come to Houston to impress anybody. We'll smile at people. We'll spread rumors. We'll scandalize someone's name. We don't know, nor do we know about them, but we want to say, I heard about Brother Hooper. Let me tell you what I heard about him. But do you know it? Sometimes I want to say, keep my name out your mouth. And I can't say that. Sometimes you got to smile at people knowing they're trying to tear you down. I can tell that love is fake. It's not real love. Proverbs 27 and verse number 6 says, faithful are the wounds of a friend, but deceitful are the wounds of an enemy. There was a quote that I read once that said, I asked God to protect me from my enemies, and then I started losing friends. Because what happens is, some of the worst people for us are the people that are closest to us. And when you start talking about being betrayed, it means of one's own. The reason why Judas was so painful, the reason why the Bible describes Judas as betraying Christ, because he was in Jesus' group. Jesus taught him. He learned from him. He ate with him. He washed his feet. He knew what he was thinking, and he was right in among the circle, and the betrayal came from somebody closest to him. See, I'm going to say this right quick, and I want to say this message to get all of us to examine who we're around and who we're associated with. The one that might be causing you the most problems is the one that you might be calling your best friend. See, you can shoot somebody from a distance, but in order to stab them, you gotta be in proximity. And in order for me to stab, see, I'm not gonna turn my back to you unless I trust you. What happens is, so many times in life, we've given the trust to man that ought to be given to God. Bible says there is a friend that's fitted closer than a brother. For me, that is Mr. Christ Jesus. Turn to Psalms 55 with me real quick. I'll be sitting down in a minute, because when Brother Tucker says sandwiches and food, he messed it up for me on this morning. And that's all some people can't think about this morning. But Psalms 55, go with me. This is David talking about Ahithophel, as he's talking about Absalom, who was in pursuit of him for his life. He said in verse number 12, he says, for it is not an enemy who reproaches me. Then I can bear it. So you know who your haters are. You know who doesn't like you on the job. He says, I can deal with them. Yes, nor is it one who hates me who has exalted himself against me. Then I can hide from him. He says, but it was you, my equal, after all sermons that I preach to you, all the hospital visits and the nursing home visits, and I married you and I did your funeral services, and there's something I said, you're ready to kick me out the door. After all that I've done to provide for you as your parent, I got up every single day and went to work. Sometimes I was tired and I had to deal with some folks that were not like me. And I tried to put food on the table, tried to make sure you had everything you need. And this is how you treat me after all that I've done for you. He says, I could bear it. I could hide from it. But it was you, my equal, my companion, my acquaintance. We took sweet counsel together. We walked to the house of God in the throne. We often turn to friends when we make life's biggest decisions, not because they will support us unquestionably, but because they will not. See, it's easy for an acquaintance to brush off an idea that sounds dumb, but it's irresponsible for a friend to do that. See, friends challenge our flaws and our thinking and our flaws and our character. And when they do that, they make us better. Good friends hold us to a higher standard when we're ready to make an excuse for ourselves. Friends sympathize with our pain, but they stop us from wallowing in it. Friends point out our blind spots, and they do so not with vindictiveness or cruelty, but out of honesty, out of love, and out of the desire that we live the life that's fulfilling and pleasing to God. And by the beginning in the spirit of fellowship, we build bonds that we experience life together in the church. Friends help us flourish. They lighten our burdens. They enlighten our thinking. They enrich our lives. When we lose sight of our commitments, they remind us of them. When we falter in our faith, they help us stand. When we grow in resilience, they do the same for us, because we need to be strong for them, and they've got to be strong for us. I've learned that Facebook and social media has messed up a lot of us when it comes to friends. Somebody says, I got 500 friends on Facebook. Let me tell you something, that don't count. I got 10,000 friends on Instagram. I got so many people following my tweets. But you know what, sometimes when people betray us, it's not just what they do, it's why you even did it. You know, think about what Judas did. It's not enough the fact that he just betrayed Christ, but you did it for 30 pieces of silver. If you're going to leave me, I'm in Houston, leave me for a Beyonce. Join up to somebody. saying, do they have my check stub right? I got enough love for my family. I got enough love for my church members. We're going the same direction. I just need to go to work to make a living. That's not even in my lesson. But it happens a lot of work. Because you have people that admire you for what you do and what you are about. In other words, I'll be somebody on my job. And some of us are so foolish to see, they're just connecting up with you because of who you are and what your name is and what your position is. And you think they like you, but they just like what you can do for them. We got the same problem sometimes in the church, especially among our fellowship in the Church of Christ. We got to respect your person. We won't even show up unless we know who's preaching. These are difficult for many people because it's not what you do, it's who you are. Senators can be corrupt. Movie stars, oftentimes on drugs and unhappy. You can be a famous billionaire such as Michael Jackson, and you need horse tranquilizers to put you to sleep. Let me tell you something. Michael Jackson has people everywhere he goes, falls out at his neck. He could have walked in this room this morning and people start screaming and going crazy. Having a bunch of folks around you won't make you happy. People cheering you on and patting you on the back. I've learned that I can pat myself on the back. And I'm like David said, encourage yourself in the Lord. Why said David encouraged himself? There was nobody around me. Good job, Sam. You did a good job. I know you didn't get the credit you deserve. Nobody calls your name. Nobody even saw what you've done. But you have a Father up in heaven who's going to reward you one day for what you've done in this life. I ain't got nobody to lay down with at night. That's why he go get you one of the big long body pillows. I said to sir, lay down next to that body pillow. I'd rather fall asleep loving myself. I'd rather hug myself at night than to be in a situation with somebody that don't love me. Let me say something to the single people. Where we are, 50% of the church is made up of single folks. And the illusion is that everybody that's married is happy. I've learned this, that half of the people that are single want to be married, and half of the people that are married. Too soon. That's why Paul said, I've learned how to be abased. I've learned how to be about everywhere, and in all things, I've been instructed to be both hungry and full, but he says, I've learned to be content. These are people who experience and share the same struggles. It's amazing how people join themselves together in times of hardship. They begin to say things like, we're going through the same thing. You and I, our kids are the same age. We've both been divorced. We're at the same place at the same time. And if you're not careful, this can deceive you into believing that you really have more in common than what you really do. Crooks often join themselves together because they have the same goal of stealing your stuff. I guarantee you, Assad and Kim Jong will come together if they want to destroy the United States. They may not like each other, but we have the same goal and same commonality. Comrades, soldiers, struggle after war with depression, they can relate to other soldiers. Marriages break up after 20 years because what happens is those soldiers who are in military, they feel like they belong and they had a purpose in life. I'm fighting for a greater cause. I'm fighting for my country. And then when I come back home, I'm just lost in the crowd. Because I have some comrades. I have some people who were fighting with me. People said, that happens a lot in marriage. You see, we've been married for 25 years, but we didn't realize that what kept us together is we were trying to raise these kids. We were trying to pay these bills. We were trying to do this and this and this and that. We looked up, and all the kids are gone, and we're like, who are you? We didn't really talk all these years. We didn't really go deeper and have fellowship. We were together because we had a common goal. We wanted our kids to see both of their parents together. We wanted to raise these kids. We wanted to buy this house. We wanted to do all these things together. We were comrades. And when it's over, you're looking crazy. Last one is a confidant. I'm going to get ready to take my seat. How many of you truly this morning have a confidant? One person. Jesus had his Peter, James, and John. And then, you know what, I was thinking, if we were in the Bible days, we would have said Jesus was cliquish. Jesus got a clique. We got this one thing to have the 12. And can you imagine how the other ones might have felt? Here go Peter, James, and John, going with Jesus again. Here they go, them three. And the Bible never really gives a detailed explanation as to why. But this shows me that Jesus had his three. It's okay that I have certain people that I gravitate to. I'm learning that there's some people, Brother Hooper, that I can be myself with, I can enjoy, I can invite them over to my house, I can let my hair down, we can play dominoes, talk about the game, and they're not even looking. But there's some folks I couldn't invite to Luby's. I saw the way Brother Bailey held his fork. They watching me. When I hang out, I don't want you watching me. I want to be able to be myself. And I realized too that don't be offended when you find out that people are doing things without you. When you find out a group of 15 brothers going on a fishing trip and you didn't know about it, did y'all forget to tell me? No, they didn't forget. But it's reciprocal. I give, you give. It's not in a relationship where one of us is pulling more weight than the other. One of us is giving more than the other. One of us is going further than the other. One of us is communicating, the other of us is shutting down. And you know what I'm telling you, when you're in a relationship, any kind of relationship, and people are just taking, there's nothing in life that'll wear you down other than giving without being able to receive. Somebody that's reliable. Somebody who can share your secrets. And let me make this clear. Most people can handle your struggle. but it's difficult to find people who can handle your success. Most people like subconsciously to see you struggle. What's wrong with you? Let me talk to you. Let me be here for you. Girl, you gotta let somebody know sometimes there's something wrong. Y'all know you try to be strong all the time, but let me be here for you. But let you come in, testify how you've been winning. How good God has been to you. How he's been blessing you. How many doors have been opened for you. And how God has been providing for you and blessing your children and blessing your marriage and blessing your life. Ain't got nothing to say. People in your life, as we get ready to close this morning, who are there for you? That's what the church is about. That's why I want to say this morning, you ought not to be a once in a while visitor to the church. God, in all of his wisdom, knew the importance of fellowship in the body of Christ. You got to have someone with you on your journey. Someone that makes you laugh, shows you kindness. Someone who gives you love and perspective. Someone who has patience with you and accepts you like Christ does us. Just the way we are. Maya Angelou said, you can't go through life with two catchers mitts on, both hands. Sometimes you gotta be able to throw something back. She said, never make someone a priority who views you as an option. They could give and take without you, but you would die without them. Then the last one, she said, don't trust people who don't love themselves, but tell you they love you. Let me ask you this. If a person does not love themselves, how in the world are they gonna show this love? See, that's what I love. As we sing, I keep falling in love with him. That's what I love about Christ. Because it seems like the closer I get to him, the stronger I become. The more sure-footed I am in my walk. She says, be careful when a naked person offers you a shirt. It is funny how the people that are always giving marital advice are the ones with the messed up marriage. Let me tell you how to raise your kids. Well, my question is, where are yours? Man, let me tell you how to work out. When's the last time you've been to the gym? Let me tell you what you should do. We're good at giving advice. Let me say this before I go. Let's start looking at our own selves. Am I the friend that I should be? Is my relationship with God what it ought to be? And sometimes this message this morning is not just about looking at the friends in your life, but looking at what kind of friend you are. Someone that people can really confide in this morning. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse number 9, Solomon speaking from reflection says, two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe unto him when he falls alone, for he has no one to help him up. Again, if two lie together, they will keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? Though he may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him, and a three-fold cord is not easily broken. The Bible says that iron sharpens iron. Proverbs 27:17. So a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. Jesus said in John chapter 15, I no longer call you servants, but I call you friends. Because what he has done is he has made known to us the will of his Father. That's what good friends do. They let us in. And I thank God that I have a friend in Jesus all this morning. He is a friend. He's not just a constituent. He's not a comrade, but he's a confidant. I can talk to Jesus when I can't talk to anyone else. He has been a friend that has stood by my side. I remember when my brother had his stroke a couple of years ago, and had a massive stroke at the age of 29, and I thought I had faith in Christ, and I thought I knew what it was to talk to Him, but sometimes you don't really learn what you're about until you go through a crisis. You don't really know how close your relationship is with someone until you go through a storm, and you don't really realize. The Bible says, Jesus said, all of you are going to scatter, because I'm going to go through something that you can't handle, but I know that God is with me. Paul says, when he was going to Jerusalem, he says, I got to go into Jerusalem, and I don't know what's going to happen to me there, but I know that I'm going to be going bound in the Spirit, and I know the Holy Spirit is going to witness there for me. I don't know what's going to happen, but he says, none of these things are going to move me. These things aren't going to shake me. These things aren't going to throw me off. We got that call, went into the hospital, and I thought I was strong. Life has a way of showing us that we're not as strong as we think we are. And I thought I was good till I see my brother in the hospital not being able to talk. I couldn't get out the words. The doctor said he had a massive stroke. Chances are he's out of here. And I remember the chaplain called our family in the room. It was my parents and the chaplain. And I remember as clear as day, everybody went around the circle to pray, and I couldn't pray. First time in my life, I didn't even know what to say to God. And I thought about the words that Paul said in Romans, the Spirit understands utterance, things that you can't even get out. But my mom said something that day, totally changed my life. And I see her reading the Bible and talking about God. And, you know, just because you talk about God, you don't really know if you're really about God. And we stood around the circle. They skipped me because I wasn't ready yet. They got to my mom, and she said, Lord, first of all, I want to thank you for giving me my baby for 27 years. And if you take him right now, thank you twice for letting me have him in my life this long. In Jesus' name, amen. And I don't know what happened. Well, I do know what happened. Seems like he started coming on back. No, I've learned that before we start asking God for stuff, I think he's waiting to see how grateful we are. Now, I'm going through a storm, and I might talk about that later, the sacrifice of praise. I'm going through a storm, and I'm not even asking you to deliver. Just thank you right now. How many feel blessed this morning? I feel blessed this morning. It ain't because the bank account is fat. It ain't because everybody likes me. But it's because of where I am in Christ Jesus. I pretty much gave you the invitation at the beginning of the sermon. There's someone here today that needs to give their life to Christ. Get added to the body of Christ. Being a faithful member of the body of Christ. Being faithful up there. There's a lot of good people in here that can help you on your journey. I'm convinced that there are a lot of people in church who would find that there are people who they would be closer to, but where we are, we don't fellowship like we should. We only see each other at church. We don't go out to dinner. We always talk about the first century church. The first century church fellowship house to house. I know some of the reason why we don't want people to come to our house is we don't want to see our stuff. Brothers, see all these flat screens. I don't know if this is what y'all wanted this morning, but this is what God put on my heart.
solidify your inner circle.
Yes, sir.
You need at least one or two or three people on your team that's going to tell you the truth, that's going to stand by you, that's going to watch with you and pray for you, and that's going to encourage you on your journey. And they got to be people that are going the same direction.
Amen.
Let us be standing. We're going to stand this morning. If you need prayer, where we are, Lord, so this is prayer time. This is prayer time. Somebody says, I've been lonely, going through it by myself, and I needed to realize this morning that I do have a friend in Jesus. You do have a friend in Christ. He's never left us. He's never forsaken us. When you were hurting, he was with you. When you were by yourself, he was with you. All your pain and sorrow, your brokenness, he was with you. Matter of fact, the reason why all of us are still here today is because of his grace and his mercy. We ought to thank him this morning. We ought to praise him this morning for what he's done. God bless you on your journey. We'll sing a song of invitation while you respond to this.